So let me just give a chance for people to say it.
Thank you for my observer. My question is in relation to operational costs and productivity. What has MIDCO done to reduce this operational cost? I've heard you touched on it a little bit. And have you found any costly contracts that you had either to be renegotiated or terminated?
Okay, to start with, in terms of our strategy, since I touched on operational costs, our strategy is basically premised on three key issues. Like I said, good quality and quantity throughput. That's number one. Number two is operational efficiencies in the system. So what we have done, and the debt reduction is one of them. Now, I want to tell you now that 60% of mid-cost source of losses was in paying interest to the banks. So if you reduce that, basically, you are making MIDCO competitive and profitable and sustainable. That is, the biggest challenge for MIDCO was the interest. 60% of MIDCO's losses, its source was based on the interest we're paying. Now, how do you address that? You address that by reducing your debts. And that's why you can see a lot of progress in terms of debt reduction. So for us, that was the biggest issue. In terms of operational costs, we have developed a new strategic plan for 5 years and an execution plan. We have revamped our systems and processes and cut down on all inefficiencies that we had in the system. We are busy aligning ourselves to the Public Procurement Act to make sure that in terms of corporate governance, we don't want to compromise on that. So we have aligned our systems, we have aligned our processes, and it has proven to bear fruits. The biggest source of uncompetitiveness for MIDCO was the interest rates. And the only way you deal with that is to make sure that you embark on an aggressive debt reduction, which we have done, if you look at where we are. And like I told you, by the end of this year, and probably by the end of next year, we should be a profitable institution. And that is inescapable. We are very serious about that, and we are very aggressive about that.
What have you done to reduce middlemen in the company? And yes, middlemen in the company supply chain, and what immediate benefits have been recorded?
So what we are busy doing, as part of operational efficiency as MIDCO, we basically said that we are not going to be an institution that exists and that relies on outsourced services. In our new strategy, we are busy internalizing all outsourced. What we did a cost-benefit analysis. And it came out very clear that it's much more cheaper when we train our own people to actually provide some of the outsourced services. So we have turned around. There are definitely benefits. It has improved our corporate governance. We have done a lot of savings. And moving forward, we are busy retaining all those services into the institution. That is one aggressive strategy which we are busy with, and it's bearing fruit. But remember, at the same time, we have got no choice because we need to make sure that we religiously and faithfully abide to the Public Procurement Act. So any expired contracts, and where there were no contracts in place, we have basically terminated them. We are busy advertising now for those services which we still need. Most of them, MIDCO is going to provide them. So our new strategy is MIDCO as an institution would actually depend and rely less on outsiders. We are building our own capacities. We are reconfiguring the institution to make sure that we provide those services.
There are reports by one foreign narrator that have been circulating targeting various public enterprises. The one that targets this institution made some insights into how MIDCO should be privatized if it's going to remain sustainable in the long term. Otherwise, it might go the Air Namibia way. I'd just like to hear you respond directly to that report that has perhaps fueled some talks in the corridor that maybe MIDCO needs to go in that direction.
I partly touched on that. I think our biggest concern from that report was, number one, we were not aware of that report. We don't know who conducted the report. We don't know who designed the terms of reference. The outcome of the report were not shared with us. We are only seeing that through WhatsApp. Now, we are professionals. We are intellectuals. We don't respond to naked opinions, to flies into the media. We are professional people. If there are any scientific assessments and research that were done to improve public policy and business, we strongly believe that there are official and professional channels on how such reports should be shared with our board and with management, and ultimately we react to that. So it will be difficult for us to comment on that report at this stage because we don't even know whether it's a factual report. I would have received that report addressed to my office in order for us to basically introspect and digest it, but unfortunately we did not get that information. But because you are the media, it's important we comment on it. I think the first issue was that report indicates that we have got a debt of around 800 million, which is not factual. It's baseless. It's not accurate information. And that should not be allowed. And such authors should not be condoned in our society because they mislead society. We are running a business. We are professional people. I gave you the real figures, the factual figures that you'll be seeing now in our annual reports in terms of our debt level. So we are stable as an institution. We are very optimistic. As per the other recommendations that were aired in that particular report, we have got a totally different perspective as management as Metro. Number one, we believe long term that in the coming 300 years, Metro should still continue to remain a wealth creator. It's a national asset, it's a national brand. It should remain competitive, it should remain sustainable and profitable. That's very, very important. And our strategy moving forward, it's premised on that. Midco being privatized, Midco being public, is not our, that's the role of government. We'll always operate within the realm of government as per government directive. For now, as per the as per PEGA, we are a commercial public enterprise, the law that we prescribe to. We have got the Meat Company Act and many other laws in the country which we prescribe to. So our strategy is based on, we are a commercial public enterprise that should create wealth for this country, generate income, generate profits, and make sure that we enhance primary production, we contribute GDP, and create employment for the people of this country. That is the role of Midco now, and that should remain the role of Midco into the future. And it's easier to achieve this role, it's not complicated. Improve on quality and quantity of throughput in the abattoir. You need to have efficiencies in the system. Make sure that you diversify your markets, both in advanced and emerging economies, and you intensify intra-Africa trade, and you keep on supporting the farmers by giving them the best price so that they realize better returns. The theory is very simple and very clear. That's the Midco we believe in, and we are going to make sure that we drive this vision aggressively, without fear or favor.
Of what impact does the continued export of the Viennas to South Africa have on the business?
Viennas, South Africa. Are you referring to Viennas?
Yes,
Viennas.
Okay, I think that's a very good question. Look, again, if you look at the advanced economies like the US, Europe, and China, all of them, during their infant industrializing stages, they use agriculture to revolutionize their economy. That is why we always say, out of the 2.3 million people you have in this country, more than 7% subsists on agriculture, directly or indirectly, because agriculture is the backbone of the economy. Now, for any economy in the 21st century, it should create employment for its people, it should generate revenue. Now, what do? You need to make sure you beef up production of your natural resources. You need to make sure that you agro-process them within the country to add value, because that way you don't end up exporting employment. You are keeping employment in the country. You are also allowing income and finance to circulate within the country. So as Midco, we have always said we need to make sure that we have got a balanced approach in terms of the available resources in the country that we should be able to slaughter to survive without affecting primary production. So what we would want to see is industrialization. And we do have the growth at home policy in this country. So NITCO prescribes purely to that when we look at the context of exportation of any raw materials out of the country.
That's wonderful. What was the reasoning behind the meat board's decision to cut the export quota, and of what impact does that have on your revenue?
The meat board did not cut on our export quota. You know, this is how the quota works. Basically, you all apply to the meat board, and then the meat board advises the Ministry of Trade in terms of out of the 1.6 ton that is available. So we were given better than what we were given in the past. There were times where we were given 50%, so we were given 70%. So we could have wanted to get more. It's good for us. But we respect the decision of government through the Minister of Trade in terms of that. So we're not threatened by that.
Okay, colleagues, you are exhausted. Elani, you are ready?
I'm fine.
Questions? Then in that case, colleagues, we'll come to the end of this press conference. Thank you so much. You have our contact.
Thank you so much.
We have some coffee here.